Now, on behalf of the board of the American Academy, it is my pleasure to bestow prizes on 3 distinguished Academy Fellows, 2 recipients of the Academy's Humanistic Studies Award, and 1 recipient of the Emerson Thoreau Medal for Literature. The Emerson Thoreau Medal was endowed in 1956 by Carol P. Haskins, the noted entomologist, inventor, and researcher. Earlier in his career, Haskins founded Haskins Laboratories in New Haven, Connecticut, where his work on the science of the spoken and written word continues today. Haskins' scientific approach to literature and his literary approach to science, hallmarks of the work of Ralph Waldo Emerson and Henry David Thoreau, and cornerstones of this Academy of Arts and Sciences, inspired him to create the Emerson Thoreau Medal for Distinguished Achievement in the broad field of literature. The first medal was awarded in 1958 to the poet Robert Frost, and subsequent recipients include T.S. Eliot, Catherine Ann Porter, Edmund Wilson, Hannah Arendt, and Saul Bellow. In 1975, the Council of the American Academy established the Humanistic Studies Award as a scholarly complement to the Emerson Thoreau Medal. Awardees have included Kenneth Burke, Meyer Abrams, and Jean-Pierre Vernon. Tonight's first Humanistic Studies Award is given to Helen Vendler, author Kinsley Porter University Professor at Harvard University. She is the 2004 National Endowment for the Humanities Jefferson Lecturer and our nation's most distinguished critic and champion of lyric poetry. She has been called, quote, a tastemaker equally respected inside and outside the Academy by the New York Times. I am delighted to call Professor Vendler to the stage and to invite Poet Laureate Natasha Trethway to help me present the award.
How high the highest candle lights the dark. You have said that you wish for every scholar a memory of the time when we were not yet scholars. Through your delight and wonder in poetry, you preserve old memories and provide new ones. From the Latin of a childhood hymn to the complexities of Wallace Stevens, you hear music in the most exalted art and in the commonplaces of everyday life, and you render your joy in a way that transcends scholarship. Greatest reader of the English lyric, of Keats and Dickinson, Heaney and Hopkins, Bishop and Ashbery, you enter a poem's architecture and cadence, the internal logic that makes a line sing. You become the voice in the poem, and then you teach us to hear the poem for ourselves. Through your work, you help us to hear our own voices. Critic and teacher, your writing is a gift to every poet and reader of poetry, a high candle lighting the way to deeper understanding and appreciation. For brightening our minds and sharing your wisdom, you exemplify the humanistic ideals of the American Academy.
Congratulations.
I too am glad to be part of this tribute to Seamus's beautiful work. And the poem I'm going to read is the last one in the sequence of poems written as elegies for his mother. Most of them, as Dennis mentioned, have many quotidian things about them, peeling potatoes, stretching sheets between mother and son. But when he comes to the end of the sequence, he writes about a chestnut tree that was planted when he was born, and then he had to see it cut down. It had been put into the earth in a hole in the garden, and then it grew into that luxuriant thing that a chestnut tree can be, and then it was axed down. And that is the thing he remembers when he's speaking of his mother's vanishing. how a vanished presence can be more real, as the decked chestnut tree is, as he says, than a real presence. I thought of walking round and round a space utterly empty, utterly a source, where the decked chestnut tree had lost its place in our front hedge among the wallflowers. The white chips jumped and skited high. I heard the hatchet's differentiated, accurate cut, the crack, the sign and collapse of what, the hatchet's accurate cut, the crack, the sigh and collapse of what luxuriated through the shocked tips and wreckage of it all. Deep planted and long gone, my coeval chestnut from a jam jar in a hole, its heft and hush become a bright nowhere, a soul ramifying and forever silent, beyond silence listened for.